All right, well, let's get started. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Institute of International Relations. My name is Benjamin Tallis, head of the Centre for European Security here at the Institute, and also editor-in-chief of the journal New Perspectives, which is an interdisciplinary journal of Central and East European politics and international relations. And it is under the auspice of the journal that we are very happy to welcome Dr. Halvard Leder from the Norwegian Institute of International Affairs, NUPI, to its friends, who in many ways embodies the interdisciplinary approach that New Perspectives takes, being a specialist in historical international relations, which will be the subject of our discussion today, doing historical IR. Halvard has written extensively in this field. He's part of the Foreign Policy and Diplomacy Research Group at NUPI, and he has a long-standing interest in this field. His PhD, which was published in 2011, is titled The Emergence of Foreign Policy, Knowledge, Discourse and History, so we can see a long-standing engagement with these topics. And more recently, Halvard, together with Benjamin de Carvalho, also of NUPI, has edited a SAGE major book series on historical international relations and has published widely in journals, including the International Studies Review, a piece I would highly recommend reading on amateurism and embracing the logic of amateurism when engaging with other disciplines. Other material was circulated in advance, and you can indeed approach us to get hold of some of Halvard's other writings, which I'm sure after this talk you will want to do. We are also very happy to hand out to you an excerpt from the forthcoming issue of New Perspectives, issue 2 of 2016, which is authored by another transgressive figure in the world of history and international relations, Derek Sayer, who will be familiar to many of you as the author of the books The Coasts of Bohemia and Prague, Capital of the 20th Century, A Surrealist History. Derek has very kindly authored what I think is a wonderful review essay for our journal, entitled Great Arches Viewed from the Coasts of Bohemia, Reflections Inspired by the Tables of Kings, which takes the previous seeming solidities and certainties of English state formation that he wrote about in the 1980s together with Philip Corrigan and destabilizes them by standing on the landscape in constant erosion that he described Bohemian state formation as being. So if you want an example of future history IR crossover, the next issue of New Perspectives is coming soon, and you have an excerpt from that. As I mentioned, this next issue that's coming out we're very excited about and has further references to history and IR, as well as other interdisciplinary engagements between IR and aesthetics. We have a piece from Roland Bleicher, and we also have a piece from Juha Vuori that looks at language, linguistic theory, and nuclear deterrence. Not perhaps an obvious immediate starting point, but one that yields some fantastic reflections. So we'll be very happy to share that with you in due course. With that said, I'm very happy to hand over to our speaker for today, Dr. Halvard Leder. Please, take us away.
Thanks. Thanks for coming. Thanks for having me. When Benjamin invited me to come, I sent him a list of things that I'm sort of working on, ranging from the half-baked ideas of things that I would like to do to the already published. And he said, yes, thank you. I'll have highlights from about half of the stuff you suggested. Focusing on the section, intersection, that is, between international relations and history. And, well, I should stress that I work at an applied research institute. I do historical stuff mainly on what I like to refer to as my spare time, pretending that something like that exists, but also when I can smuggle historical topics into other projects. So this is something that I'm not working on full-time, but it's something that's probably the closest to my heart. But it just so happens that my partner in crime, which is the other Benjamin, the one not in the room, he's not here today, Benjamin de Carvalho, because he went to Prague without me earlier this year. So I come without him now. There's a tit-for-tat going on here. But we have been discussing writing a short introductory text based on stuff that we have been thinking about for some years, called something like Doing Historical International Relations. So what I decided to do is that I'll try to pull excerpts from things that I have been writing and pull them together and see if we can get towards an outline of the book. So this is what you're getting today is my very first stab at knitting together different bits and pieces from the last 4 or 5 years of work. I can assure you that the underlying texts have been through rigorous peer review, but I apologize up front if what comes out today might not seem convincing. I'd love your input on how this could be taken forward and what should be in a book called Doing International Relations for an IR crowd. So, What I want to do today under the heading of doing international relations, doing historical international relations, is the following. First, I'll very briefly establish why IR needs history, and thus why we need to think more seriously about history. Secondly, I'll discuss how IR as a discipline has dealt with history, with a particular focus on constructivist takes. And this is, in a sense, I'll try to provide a description of how history has been done in IR. And thirdly, I want to spend some more time presenting some nuts and bolts of doing historical as what I refer to as engaged amateurs. Randomness, path dependencies, and so on and so forth. Arthur Gilbert wrote in International Studies Quarterly, 50 years ago, said that studying history alerts us to what he quote unquote calls the ironic nature of human affairs, which I think is a good starting point. Christopher Thorpe said, more bluntly, history is too important to be left to the historians. I would tend to agree, not because I have anything against historians, but I think it's because I think history is really, really important. However, and this is important as well, history is not just out there to be appropriated. And this is what I think a problem of many ways in which international relations and political science and social sciences more generally have approached history. It's just, it's a nice quarry out there with historical facts that we can mine. We can just go in, pick up a lump and say, look, I have proof. I've discovered history. This tells me what it's really like. And the old-fashioned Rankean notion of history, what it was really like. So, and of course, anyone who knows any history knows that historians have left this notion of history behind. I mean, there are very few historians who still stick to this notion of history. So conveniently, international relations still sticks to ways of doing history which were outmoded in history a number of years ago. But still, this sort of, I think, cautions us that we need to engage history seriously, to some extent, on the terms of historians. Although we should not become historians. And I'll return to that later. So, that was why I think history is important, short story. How has international relations dealt with history? Well, academic international relations did, to some extent, grow out of history. It's one of the parent disciplines. Under the first generations of scholars, I mean, an active engagement with history is really, that's the way to study international relations, right? The English school, Martin White famously wrote, "Why is there no international theory?" in 1960, making the argument, well, there can be no international theory because history. That's really his sort of, his short answer is that history makes it impossible. The onwards, the random wanderings of history makes it impossible to have an international relations theory. I beg to differ, but still, that was a strong claim that what we were doing, and it was sort of his argument, is that all the best international relations can do is present sort of the philosophy of history. To many of these early scholars, both in the US actually and in Britain, I mean, history is self-evident. History is what you do when you're doing historic or doing international relations. But again, this is challenging. You've got to know the story. I mean, you have the emergence of behaviorism in the United States. You have eventually what's been called neo-positivism systems theory in the 50s and 60s, and producing eventually Waltzian neorealism and then again what is referred to as a neo-neosynthesis, where history is really being used, if it's being used at all, to create an ahistorical theory. Whereas White would say history proves that why there can be no international theory, to Waltz, if you want to sort of be very blunt about it, history shows that history doesn't matter, right? The world is about the systems and the structure that are unlike units, and the variation is about distribution of capabilities. That's it. Some states grow, some states fall, and that's it. It's more or less about recurrence. Now, a reaction against this, as you all know as well, happens starting around 1980 under the umbrella of what was usually called critical theories, right? Not in the narrow Frankfurt School notion of critical theory, but in the broader sense of people reacting against this. Within international relations, I think the two most important strands where this has been taken up has been in historical sociology, with the likes of Justin Rosenberg, John Hobson, George Lawson, and others, and in what we could refer to as broad tent constructivism. So I'll spend most of my time on history and constructivism. That's partly because I've written about it, but also because I think this is where I see the best opportunities for doing historical international relations while interacting with the discipline and with historians. I'm not saying it's the only way to do historical international relations, not at all. I'm not necessarily saying it's the best, but I think it's the one that provides best for what I would like to think of as engagement. you know, I should sort of rush to say that I have a very broad notion of constructivism here. Many of my writings have been inspired by Foucault, for instance, and I have no problems with that. I wouldn't necessarily call myself a constructivist, but that's a different story. Still, when we sort of sat down, the other Benjamin and I, to think about this, we were tasked with saying something about generations of constructivists and history, and we found out that, to us, one of the ways in which it makes sense to talk about generations of constructivists is actually through their approach to history. First generation constructivists, the big names, the big shots of the 80s. There's Fritz Kratochwill, there's Nick Onuf, there's John Ruggie, but there's also the people in sort of working on similar topics but from slightly different approaches, like Rob Walker and Richard Ashley. These people are mainly, the way we see it, using history to launch a meta attack against the neo mainstream. They're saying, well, basically, you say that there is a structural determinant here that history is sort of, in a sense, always repeating. Well, what we can show you is that, you know, you can't really deal with the medieval to modern transition, which is a massive transition. Now, historians have challenged that later, but that's not the story. But to these early constructivists, history is there. But history is there mainly sort of as a meta-attack on the neo-neo sentences. Saying that, well, history, using mainly secondary sources, saying that, well, history actually shows us that the world has been changing. And if you have a theory positing that change isn't going to happen, that change is only going to be incremental and everything's going to be repeating, you can't really account for this. Thus, there's a serious flaw in your theorizing. But they're still working at a fairly general level. You don't see, I mean, Rob Walker or John Ruggie engaging with primary sources. I mean, John Ruggie, of course, had a very good overview of the secondary sources. But I mean, a lot of this happens at a philosophical level or a history philosophical level, right? Rob Walker famously sort of argues against the inside-outside distinction, but I mean, the extent that he engages with history at all is reading Thomas Hobbes. Well, there's nothing wrong with Thomas Hobbes, but still, there is that. So, moving on to what we would call the second generation, often, well, largely coextensive with what other people refer to as soft constructivism or American constructivism, there is a desire not so much to criticize the mainstream as to engage with the mainstream. Taking up topics which the mainstream has argued is either not that important or really important, and saying, well, yes, actually, you can deal with these topics, and they show that ideas and norms, particularly norms are big in the 1990s, that they really matter, right? Look, we have human rights. We can show you how human rights are socially constructed. But the cost of this is a smoothening of historical narrative. There are very few fits and starts here. There are virtually no dead ends. I would argue that there is a more or less underlying logic of a progressive, almost Whiggish history. I mean, the world is, this is the end of history notion, right? This is Fukuyama written to IR. Look, we are becoming more and more norms regulated. And also you tend to sort of use these things as variables, right? We have to talk to the mainstream, they deal with variables. Thus, you find in Jefferson, Wenton, Katzenstein, which is a terribly important piece of the mid-1990s. I mean, the culture of national security, everyone read that in the late 1990s. They were basically making the theoretical argument that norms should be understood as an leading variable. There are so many problems with that I don't even start. But really, so change matters to these people, and they want to study change and use it as a leverage to engage with the mainstream. But the historical analysis tend to be fairly shallow. And there's also the interesting discrepancy in that when they're dealing with fairly sort of current history, dealing with sort of with the people who are still living, they are self-reflective to an extent. They go out and make interviews and they reflect on where the people come from and where they're situated and how situatedness matter and so on and so forth. Dealing with the history of the dead, that's all gone. Look, I found this. This proves that, this proves human rights. It's important in the 1920s, right? There's no situatedness. They're just, oh, there's a source. There is a source. That can tell me the truth about the matter. So it's sort of, you end up with a sort of relatively shallow historical analysis and change largely understood as unidirectional. Change is for the better. Now, for a number of reasons, what I would refer to as the third generation has been skeptical against this narrative. Of course, I tend to see these changes between generations driven partly by external affairs and partly by internal affairs. One thing is external affairs, meaning external shocks, the fall of the Berlin Wall, often used as a sort of why constructivism happens. Well, of course, that just sort of conveniently ignores that most of the early constructivists started writing about these things 10 years earlier. So I think you can't understand the history of international relations as a discipline purely from external affairs. Some people like to tell it from sort of, oh, there's a reaction against 9/11. Yes, there is a reaction against 9/11. There's also a reaction of a new generation of people coming up and saying that this second generation of constructivism doesn't really cut it. It's not enough. It's too liberal, Whiggish, too positive in a sense. So if you have a broad group of people, I don't think they would necessarily recognize themselves as a generation, but most of them know one another. Most of them go to conferences together, write on fairly, if not similar topics. They have the ability to engage in conversation. Now, I think gone here are the sweeping Whiggish generalizations and the gradual notion of a gradual spread and strengthening of norms. There's more narratives of change, but they're explicitly articulated as such. Uses arguments against this optimism of the second generation. In general, I think you're seeing careful engagement with the past, people trying to say, well, in a sense, returning to some of the topics of the first generation, how history is not unidirectional, how history sort of moves and fits and starts, but doing it through much more serious engagement, much more micro scale, typically, but also with the actual engagement with historiography, acknowledging that historians have different positions as well. Wow, surprise. International relations is not the only discipline that has internal debates. Wow, historians have them as well. How peculiar. But also sort of saying that, well, so the overall move, okay, from the first to the third generation, I think is a move from the general to the particular, but also a move from secondary towards primary sources. I'd like to sort of point out my I think the best example of this. This is Anne Town's book on the notion of women's rights as a normal civilization, where she engages historiography, titiates within historiography, and deals with primary sources, which is really thorough, really, really good, solid piece of what I would refer to as third generation constructivism. Here you also see people saying, well, constructivism here, constructivism there, doesn't really matter. I mean, we don't have to sort of necessarily associate ourselves with the sociologists of this. I mean, we'll all borrow something from Foucault, I'll borrow something from Bourdieu, whatever works, in a sense. People are sort of not, I think that generation of constructivism is much more open than the previous, at least the second generation, and people tend to care less about the mainstream, which is not necessarily a wise career move, my friends, but then again, if you're lucky, you might sit here and talk to Benjamin.
So we're really lucky, yeah.
How should we do this? I think the third generation has had some good ideas. And I think it's important, again, I mean, I'm doing historical international relations, it's not a panacea for any ills, it's not easy, it's not necessarily, you're not necessarily going to be successful. I mean, it's time consuming, first of all, to try to be fluent in two tongues. And one thing is you should strive to know IR as well as you can, of course. But if you want to know at least parts of another discipline well, it's going to take time. And if you want to deal with primary sources, it takes time. Second, you might discover that your work falls outside of both disciplines, both IR and history. Now, I think the people doing historical sociology has proved that it's possible to carve out a niche. I think Benjamin de Carvalho and I have proved that it's possible to sort of make a niche for historical IR as well. People are actually able to at least go to conferences, hopefully eventually also be published doing historical international relations, but it's not easy. And you might even risk that work isn't, even if you do good work, even if it is sort of accepted as competent work, perhaps if you're lucky, it's accepted as competent both by IR and historians, right? But still, people might not pick it up. Might not have any sort of, you might end up with people not reading your work. But again, that's common to everyone working in international relations as the discipline is becoming more and more fragmented. So I think the modest aim one should have is to nudging thought forward and creating openings. Again, this is one of my leitmotifs of this project, creating openings. So how should we approach history? I think, in my thinking, I've fastened on the notion of amateurism, engaged amateurism, and this necessitates a little clarification. I'm not thinking about amateurism as doing something poorly. That's very important. I'm not desiring to be an amateur as opposed to someone who's doing something really well. I'll do it. I can play chess as a really, really bad amateur, right? But that means just I suck at chess. That's not what I'm getting at. I mean, it's different. You differentiate amateurism from professionalism, but the criteria for differentiation is not payment. I would love to be paid for doing historical national relations, thank you very much. But it's and on our quality. I think what distinguishes an amateur is not that he or she is paid, not that he or she is doing something in an inexpert way. It's, and I borrow from Edouard Said, who writes that amateurism is about the desire to be moved not by profit or reward, but by love for and unquenchable interest in the larger picture, in making connections across lines and barriers, in refusing to be tied down to a specialty, in caring for ideals and values despite the restrictions of a profession. It's about breaking free of the confines of the profession. It's doing something for the love of it. It's doing something because you can't really stand the sort of fact of not doing it. Which is why I do history, of course, because I can't stop. I mean, stopping would mean sort of stopping being who I am. So I think amateurism, in this understanding, implies being curiosity-driven rather than theory-driven or driven by the profession, but also recognition of the fact that we are not historians and we should not strive to be. But I think this Saidan notion of amateurism is it drives us towards being critical intellectuals. My research has tended to be question driven. I'm curious about things. And I would like to go to where I think I can find answers to my questions. And which is why I think this is why I need history, right? In my perspective, I can't answer the questions that I want answers to without engaging with history. So being critical intellectuals, I like to use the Foucauldian version when Foucault says that practicing criticism is about making facile gestures difficult. Mm-hmm. That's what being a critical intellectual, one of the things that being a critical intellectual can be about, and one of the things I find historically in history enormously effective in doing, in making facile gestures difficult. Making life more difficult for policymakers, saying, well, is it really that simple? How did we end up here? How did this become taken for granted? That's the kind of questions that drive me. I mean, you might obviously be driven by other kinds of questions. But again, this is where I come from and why I think amateurism captures it fairly well. So, methods. All methods, as I said at the outset, just moving from the general notion of amateurism more specifically to the methods, all methods are in a sense historical. And there is an interesting divergence here in that if you're in an Anglo-American tradition, you talk about historical methods, people are sort of, well, historical methods are the methods used by historians. Duh. You'll find a chapter in one of the handbooks of IR on historical methods, and it's really about how different IR people have been doing history. Well, you're not going to find a single word on specific methods in that chapter. Although if you move to a German Scandinavian tradition of history, historical methods is all about engagement with the sources. Source criticism. If you say source criticism in an Anglo-American context, people think you're studying the Bible. So it's a confusion of language. But I think the tools that historians have developed for dealing with sources are really something that could be useful to social scientists in general, but to IR scholars in particular. And I think partly that's just that, I was trained at a fairly positivist department of political science, but others are, of course, exposed to the same thing. We have a really, really massive focus on how to analyze data. Right? There's an enormously sophisticated mathematical, quantitative, but also qualitative methods of studying data. There's almost no focus on the gathering of data, right? And what data might mean. Let me make an obvious example. I mean, our colleagues at Prio in Oslo, some of them are fantastic with numbers. I mean, they crunch numbers with the best of them, and they do. But, I mean, the ones and the zeros, I mean, a state is a state is a state in that perspective. Right? You count a state. You count a war as 1,000 dead people in a year. Well, you don't really factor into the, sort of, you don't even care about sort of, if war in the 21st century is different from Napoleonic Wars, right? To some of us, they are fairly different. and what counts, and how do you count this? How can you count, right, in that way? I find that very difficult. But I think it brings out the point, I think, that what might the data mean? How can we make data mean things? And how do we actually go about gathering them? And what I'm going to say now might seem really banal. Like those of you with a training in history, and you might say, oh, well, yeah, he's really saying the obvious here. Yes, I am saying the obvious. But there are so many people in international relations who don't know anything about it. Like, people say, wow. So yes, some of you might think, now he's really, really putting out a simple level. I apologize up front. But I find that many, many people haven't thought about these things at all, which is why I think they need to be said. Starting at the obvious beginning, nothing counts as a source until you ask a question. Sources aren't just out there. No source speaks for itself. The source doesn't tell you anything unless you ask a question of it. That also means that anything can be used as a source. Now, the utilization is key here. There are many different ways of utilizing sources, and I'll focus on man-made sources. Of course, there can be non-man-made sources, but we'll leave that for another time. There are two kinds of ways of utilizing a source. You can utilize it as a silent source. Some sources can only be utilized as silent sources, right? If you go out and dig up something, you find an axe. That axe doesn't talk to you. If you find a book, the book might talk to you. So silent sources are sources that tell us something about their conditions of production and existence, but in principle, nothing more. Well, of course, you'll tend to weave them into narratives so they don't end up telling you more. But narrative sources tell you more, right? The narrative sources, they have a narrative as well. They don't, I mean, you find a book, the book can tell you something about its sort of its production, you can say something about how could a book exist at that time, but it also has a content. They refer to something beyond their condition of production. They are speaking sources, so to say. Texts are a typical example, but as we know in IR, other kinds of visual and audio sources can be treated in the same way. Pictures, movies, radio broadcasts, and the list goes on, in principle. And they can be treated. They can be treated as silent sources. They can be treated as relics. They can be treated in a way that they tell us something about their condition of production. But they can also give us some insights into what the narrative is all about. And I think all too often, IR scholars focus, and social scientists in general, focus only on the second part. Namely that, ooh, this narrative tells me something about something. And they forget that narratives themselves have a story or origin. Right, they forget the fact that, well, this source is produced by someone at some point for some purpose. Right, there's an, ooh, a text. This text tells me. I mean, if you pick up the notes of my lecture today, ooh, this is the truth about historical international relations. Well, you should actually think about this as being something produced for this specific occasion, invited to say something about this for this kind of crowd. That matters for how you interpret this source, right? Hopefully. So, historians tend to divide these kinds of sources into three different kinds, these talking sources, if you like. Literary sources, sources with a message, explicitly telling a story, newspaper articles, journal articles, novels. These are fairly common sources for our people. These are the things we look to. I mean, newspaper articles, very common source. Those are also, in a sense, the most difficult to assess. Because there is a story of origin that might be difficult to assess. I mean, you might not know. If you read a newspaper article from the 18th century, well, you need to do some work to find out, sort of, okay, is this an opposition paper? Is it a government paper? What's the sort of situation you're in? What's the debate that is? What's the intertextuality here? And so on and so forth. So many historians prefer the drier sources. Let's say the official sources, so the technical ones, the ones often referred to as diplomatic, which means that they're dealing with diplomas, judicial, court records, treaties, laws, will, contracts. These are something they're established for a specific purpose. They don't have a narrative. They tell you something that has happened. And finally, there are the third kind is sources that we can talk about, social documents, the stuff typically produced by government officials, ministries, bureaucracies, civil society associations, and so on and so forth. Now, these kinds of sources, I think, can yield enormous results for IR scholars and social scientists. And we tend to overlook them because they're difficult, and you often find them in the archives, which are scary, right? Of course, the best way to aim, to sort of, to, or not the best way, perhaps, one of the really, really good ways of gaining academic credentials within among social scientists and so on. Yeah, I've actually been doing some research in the archives. Wow. I mean, sometimes I think they look at you like you're some sort of academic equivalent to the Cirque du Soleil, right? And you're dancing around doing strange things. I mean, I can't do that, but it's really, really impressive. which is not what studying in the archives is like at all, but this is nimbus that you get this aura of. You dealt with primary source in an archive. Wow, you are a really, really serious scholar. Well, I hope I'm a serious scholar, but that not because I've been to archives. Also, I think important distinction that needs to be made is between primary and secondary sources. A primary source is, of course, the first available source about something, like a journal entry, a royal promulgation or something. Secondary source is something that builds on other sources. Most of the books that we'll pick up by historians are secondary sources, or even tertiary, or so on and so forth. There's nothing wrong with using secondary sources. I mean, this is one debate that I've been having with George Lawson and others, on and off, sort of. Well, George is perfectly happy in relying on secondary sources. Of course, he does historical sociology. But again, there's nothing wrong with using secondary sources. And I think, on the contrary, I mean, it can be argued that most attempts at creating any sort of overarching historical account has to draw on secondary sources. I mean, you can't deal with primary sources for everything. It's impossible. However, again, what is often forgotten, this is often forgotten by social scientists when they're turning to history. I mean, they're turning to history to confirm. I mean, this is why I'm saying when you're reading history through theoretical lenses, you're looking for something to confirm your story, which means that you conveniently forget or ignore, because you don't know it, that historians approach sources from specific theoretical or methodological perspectives. They try to make an impact among their own peers. We're engaged in exactly the same kinds of academic games that we're engaged in. So historians necessarily interpret data. They make more or less well-informed choices about which sources to consult. And on top of this bias that historians have, this is a necessary bias of doing research, right? You can't sort of just approach the source without no bias. You have a preconceived notion of something. But you sort of add to this and sort of unconscious selection bias of the IR scholar. You pick some secondary histories of a topic. So you end up with historians believing this sort of Rankean notion of history is out there to be discovered, ignoring. I mean, this is galls me when constructivists do this, because constructivism has, of course, a separate notion, at least the more sophisticated, the notion of double hermeneutics, right? I mean, we're dealing with the construction of social reality out there and with the social construction of knowledge among the researchers. Stefano Guzzini has a wonderful 2000 article in EJR about this. This is self-reflexivity, right? We are a step removed. We cannot move into the heads of the people we study, and we sort of form our knowledge in a social way. And then we go out and look at historical sources and we forget all about that. We just assume that, oh, this is the truth about this matter. Forgetting that the historians are in the same position dealing with their primary sources that we are when dealing with the study things that we study. So I think there are no full remedies for this, but the partial remedy is one, widening historiographical scope. If you're going to read secondary sources, read more secondary sources and try to find out what the historians are debating. Don't end up sort of reproducing what the Marxist historians of the 60s said. History moves. They have the same kinds of terms that we had, right? They had a linguistic turn. For some reason, haven't had an historical turn. But still. And secondly, I think really, primary sources should be, at least, I mean, everyone who does historical IR should at least once try to engage with primary sources, and that's becoming so much easier with the world becoming more digital. Mm-hmm. Primary source isn't as frightening as it used to be. Even if you're looking at texts as a resource, I mean, Google Scholar has enormous amount of other databases as well, some of them with fairly low paywalls, can give you access to enormous amount of written material. And even if you want to go into archives, I mean, they have now presentations of their collections digitally. So you can actually sort of look through their collections and find, okay, I want to look at those and those and those boxes. You can order them. They'll be sitting at your desk when you arrive at the actual archive. You can spend one day going through it with your digital camera, and then you can go back to the cozy confines of your office and not sit in the archive and deal with this like you deal with other sort of printed sources. So, and I've been stunting in and out of archives for a number of years, and it's become so much easier only over the last 10 years that I've been doing it. You can actually, the threshold should be much lower. Now, I'm getting towards the end here, I realise. But at some point, someone usually asks them, yeah, and this is again, could be George Lawson. I wouldn't name any names, but it could be George. Saying, why should we bother dealing with primary sources when historians are better trained to handle them? Why go the extra mile? Well, I still think that engagement with primary sources makes for better research and might even lead IR scholars in some instances beyond the historians. And the reason why I say this is that, well, first, engaging with primary sources almost by default leads to some sort of contemplation about which sources have survived, which ones should be consulted. If you go into an archive, you very, very rapidly realize that, wow, historians make choices as well. The stuff that you find in the history books are just tiny, tiny slice of the available source material because there's just so much being produced. And thus, hopefully, if you can engage with primary sources, you start to critically scrutinize how historians have picked their sources. What have they been thinking about? Why have they looked at those boxes rather than that slot over there? Why have they chosen that kind of data? And as social scientists, I think we might ask different kinds of questions. I mean, we might ask different kinds of questions of the sources that the historians have already looked at, or we might even be interested in other kinds of sources. This is where I think we could add something to what the historians do. Also, I think for a number, at least, of historians, what IR adds is the international. I mean, history is, of course, the nation-building discipline par excellence. And there's a reason why not too many international scholars write about Norwegian history, right? Thus, Norwegian historians write about Norwegian history. Perfectly good reasons for this. This also implies that not all, by far not all, but a relatively large number of historians don't necessarily think that much about the international. They approach the world with their nationalist lenses on. Not nationalist in a nasty political way, but in the sense of, yeah, they come from a national tradition of studying their nation's history. So what we can add to that, at least as IR scholars, is the notion of a comparison. Right? There actually might be things to be gained from doing comparative work. But also saying, yeah, but we should not forget that the things that we study in the national context is actually imbricated in these sort of international contexts. I mean, there's the number of times where I said that, well, yes, it's well and good that we're studying this topic and how this is important for Norway, but we're missing out on foreign policy, guys. I mean, we want to study policy, yeah, what about foreign policy, but what about the world? Mm. Shouldn't we sort of acknowledge at least that we're part of something bigger than ourselves? So, I promise, I've already said something about what I think we can offer. And I think the external promise of international relations is that we can be able to talk to historians. Hopefully we will do historical IR in a way that they find that we're not only sort of amateurs in the sense that we don't know our stuff. I've found that if you take the time and effort to actually engage seriously with the historiography and maybe even with primary sources, well, first of all, many historians are really thankful. Wow, you're going the extra mile. You actually care. And then you might actually get into very productive discussions because you deal with the same kinds of things but from different vantage points. Those are, well, obviously, I think, the most interesting debates. The ones who think, wow, that's a really cool way of thinking about that. I haven't thought about it that way. And I had that reaction from some historians when I said, wow, I really disagree. That's a cool way of thinking about it. And I think that means you're getting somewhere. We are actually, maybe we can sort of alert historians to sources that they haven't thought about. Maybe we can alert them to ways of thinking about sort of the international as important when they might be more concerned with the national. Second, internally, I think what historical international relations offer is a one way of counter the fragmentation of the discipline. I mean, I think it's a paradox that the more the discipline of IR knows, and we know more and more things, I mean, there are more and more people doing international relations, the more and more sophisticated methods, the more and more wider and wider variety of theoretical ways, but still the less of the discipline each of us know. IR as discipline knows more and more, but we as individual scholars know less and less of the discipline because we're moving forwards in all directions, right? And when was the last time I never read a journal from cover to cover, but some of those the last time I actually held a physical journal in my hand. I don't know what goes on in peace research. I don't know what goes on in most of the national relations. You know, it's impossible to catch up. However, what historical international relations offer, I think, is one way of a lowest common denominator for IR, because we are all, if you like it or not, historians. You know, we deal with things that have happened. And if we approach it out as amateurs, again, with the notion of doing it for the love of it, and we can, I think, strike up conversation. I'm speaking to some extent here from my own experiences. When you're discussing history, it's much easier to communicate across theoretical boundaries. It's much easier to sort of find creative engagements. There are fewer preconceived notions, more curiosity, and of course, one of the reasons is that there are the policy implications might not be as high. Now, if your topic of study is current-day Russia, your theoretical perspective might be really, really important to what you sort of prescribe as policy. Thus, it's really, really hard to compromise. It'll be really, really hard even to listen to the other, right? Because I have this theory of Russia, and this theory implies that we should follow policy X, and you have another theory, and that implies that we should follow policy Z. And those things don't go together. Whereas if we study 16th century Europe, our theories don't lead to any specific policy recommendations. I hope at least that they don't. But then maybe, and this I find when you sit down with IR scholars discussing the further back you go in history, really, to the further you come from policy recommendations, the easier it becomes to have engaged, lively conversation, the easier it becomes for people to say, well, actually, your theory might give us a better perspective on that. Cool, this works. And you get to these conversations where people might, in the end, end up be still disagreeing, but at least you're having the conversations. So I think that when working historically, IR scholars seem to be experimenting with theories and methods more freely than when dealing with current affairs. So I think that history allows us, or doing historical international relations, can allow us to be in sort of a sandbox setting, as they like to say, the app developers, or a laboratory. We can have some sort of lingua franca. I mean, we're talking about some of the same things. So conversations can cross subdisciplinary boundaries. We can become exposed to different ways of thinking about the same issues, where curiosity and interest in the big picture is more likely to inform research. So I think moving from our different specialities, where IR scholars tend to be more and more professional, to a field where we can engage as amateurs on a relatively equal footing, carries the promise of a more pluralist discipline and the more intellectually open profession. And with that, I've finished. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much indeed. You've opened up all sorts of issues I think we can discuss, many of which I think will be familiar to the editorial team of the journal New Perspectives, and which I will engage with a little bit more later. But we are very lucky to be joined by a member of the editorial team of New Perspectives, Dr. Teresa Valli, who is a historian. So we've done it. We've actually asked a professional to take on the engaged amateurism that has been advocated, and I think very compellingly so, by Halvard. Moreover, Teresa also did her PhD together with Derek Sayer here of historical sociology, and history and sociology combined. So we have, I think, plenty of background to chew on there as well. I'll hand over to Teresa, who's our discussant for today. Please.
Excellent. Thank you very much for a great and engaging paper. So I have so many, and I, you know, when you mentioned the historian being difficult, that's just sort of okay. So I had some initial questions. When encountering a kind of, you mentioned the narrative anyway, so let's talk a little bit about the narrative. So I think that as historians, we're kind of aware of the fact that we're working in a limited, you know, within a constructed and a limited narrative. And I think that that is what, going back to kind of Trouillot and, you know, talking about silences, you know, sort of moving margins, pushing margins, shedding some light on those silences. I think that is perhaps a place where this intersection between history and IR can become incredibly useful for history as well. So, what I obviously, this is not in an endeavor to come to some kind of the complete truth about a story. Truth must be rejected, but just some form of knowledge. But it's always, you know, when history serves identity in this sense, I think it's always sort of malleable and it's very open. And therefore, history, I find it to be, unfortunately, sometimes a very self-defeating discipline in that sense. I mean, I can't speak for all historians, obviously, but myself, when trying to discuss notions such as, you know, the constructs of racism in the 19th century, something Bill here knows very much about, another historian in the room, but also, when discussing topics like this, I found that history does have those limits, and it comes up against walls where it needs to engage on a broader sense. And you mentioned the international, so perhaps in a different way, maybe not in a sociological sense, in an anthropological sense, which is what I might perhaps be more familiar with, but what then can international relations bring to history, I guess is my question to you. So if you could elaborate a little bit more on that and tell me about the ways in which you can push history, I'd be really interested to hear about that.
Should I start with that, or do you want to?
Yeah, no, start with that.
There are a few things that come to mind first. Okay. One of them is again, the feeling that, or there's not the feeling, there's the fact, I think, that historians, many historians work within national frameworks.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. No, of course, I mean, there is a...
But you keep saying that, but it's simply not true.
Well,
it's not true of the best historiography today.
Not the best, not of all, but I mean, of course, this might be a reflection of being Norwegian. But there is, yes. And Norwegian history has been famously known for its mythological nationalism. That's not my word, actually, that's the word of people reviewing it. But what I think is that, and of course you shouldn't discount that there's a burgeoning field of international history and global history, I mean, which is doing fascinating stuff. That should not be forgotten.
Mm-hmm.
But again, I think typically this is, many other people doing global histories, go back a few centuries. I think as soon as you get to the period of national historiographies, when historians as nation builders, there is more of a struggle to overcome that sort of, at least again from a Scandinavian perspective, what I can offer as an international relations scholar is a comparative one. It's okay.
Okay.
Rather than seeing your nation as unique, I'll give you an example. We had a project at Newby a couple of years ago when we're celebrating the bicentenary of the Norwegian Constitution. The Norwegian Constitution was written in 1814. We were celebrating sort of 2014. And what we said, well, Norway was then part of a Copenhagen-led, what historians tend to refer to as a conglomerate state or composite state, which had colonies in West Africa, in the Caribbean, in India, and Denmark and Norway, and the duchies of Schleswig and Holstein. And sort of, so we said, okay, let's take the Norwegian Empire from international relations and sociology and throw that at the case and see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
And the historians first said, yeah, get real, come on, you can't do that. And then we had seminars and we show what we were doing and they said, oh, okay, cool. We still disagree, but it's cool. This is opening up new ways of thinking. This is sort of, that's the kind of thing that comes into focus if you're looking at, for instance, you're looking at the theory of central periphery, theory of imperialism, right?
Wallerstein.
Wallerstein, but also the ones going further from Wallerstein, also with Tractili and the
okay, yeah.
That kind of way of thinking in international relations. You have the piece by Dan Nixon I can't remember the other guy in one of the big, really, really big journals. Core and peripheries, and of course I have the notion of semi-peripheries.
Mm-hmm.
What we played with, one of my colleagues said, well, okay, what if you look at Norway and compare that to the role of Scotland and the British Empire, and look at them as semi-cores.
Okay.
They're not exactly, they're not the core, but let's see, the historians are nodding, right? And that was the reaction from the Norwegian historians. Well, cool. You might not agree, but it opens up new ways of thinking, right?
Yeah.
Because, to us, that was an obvious choice, but it's something you can do. you look for, okay, because Norway doesn't really look like a periphery in that kind of, in the setting. Mm-hmm. It's much too central, and there's so much overlap between the elite of Norway and Denmark, as they bilingual, or the same language. When Norway and Denmark splits in 1814, part of the members of a family who are located in Norway stick with Norway, the ones who are located in Denmark stick with Denmark. So it doesn't make sense to call Norway a periphery. But it doesn't really make sense to call it a center either, because I mean, Copenhagen is the center. And Norway is in some ways more central than parts of Denmark proper. So how do you get to that? Okay, so the theoretical innovation is to call it a semi-core, and the empirical sort of new thing to Norwegian historians, at least, was sort of compared to Scotland. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what are the parallel functions that you can find in sort of Scotland and British Empire and Norway in the Danish Norwegian or the Copenhagen-led empire? That's one thing I think that we
can.
The other thing is, and again, depends on how nationalists or nation-oriented the historians are. But there are so many times I've been sitting in with not only with historians, but social scientists in general, saying, well, what about the international? What about the, the Research Council wants to have a project on, another example is easy to show this example. The Research Council of Norway said that a few years ago, well, we want people to study societal risks, right? Big thing after 9/11 and after terrorist attacks and after Ulrich Beck and also and so forth. You need sort of risk society and assessment. So how can we better protect our citizens? And we wrote sort of a pre-application saying, this is an excellent question. How do we deal with the fact that 3-5% of the population is at any one time outside of the Norwegian borders? That's a really good question. We hadn't thought about that. And this is sort of, and this I find as an international relations scholar, and it's not only when dealing with historians, but dealing with sort of, people tend to forget that sort of we are part of something bigger, because I mean, so many of our institutions are set up to deal with national topics. And there is no quote unquote natural constituency for international stuff. So I find that intellectually and academically, IR can act as a sort of reminder, not, and this is again not only to historians and not to all historians, because some of the best work in this is sort of, these kinds of things have been done by historians. I mean, Osterhammel's book for the last couple that came out a couple of years ago, and it's like there's a reason why it's been so popular and been so much cited. But in many settings, I think that's the other thing we can offer, the fact that you need to actually think. To sort of bring the world into your thinking. Again, this is not an attack on historians per se, it's an attack against some ways of doing history and some ways of doing social science. Mm-hmm. Because this is sort of a problem going through the social sciences in general as well. I mean, yes, but what about the international? So that's the two sort of, there are obviously other things that smarter people than me would say, but these are things that I've been thinking about. I tend to think practically about these things. Some people would approach this through the philosophy of science or something, but I tend to be practical and pragmatic. So these are, I think, very, very specific things that we can offer to historians.
Thank you. We'll turn to our discussant again. And then after we've had a few more of these type of engagements, we'll come out to the room
to be shorter
for questions. No, that was superb. So thanks. Please tell us.
Yeah. So another thing that you mentioned intrigued me quite a bit. You talked about his sort of... being able to learn from history in the sense that history can move something that happened in the unobservable realm of the past, that historical methodology can help move this event or this space or whatever it was into contemporary observation. And I would say that for me as a historian, that's kind of a point of construct in, you know, a construct, at least a narration that occurs somewhere in that process. And does, I guess my question to you would be then, does, you know, IR recognize that or acknowledge that that's part of the historical approach to this? Like,
yeah, that's an excellent question. And that, I didn't say anything about that today. It comes out from the texts. Okay. I recognize it from And the reason for writing that is, and I'm not really trying to defend a point here, but I'm trying, this again goes into to another discussion.
Mm-hmm.
This one I had with Vincent Pouliot about studying practice.
Okay.
And of course, I'm not necessarily a big fan of the practice term for a number of reasons, but how do you, I mean, if you think as practice as something in principle observable, how do you deal with the practice of the dead?
Mm-hmm.
I think that the practice term has been much too cavalier in dealing with practices of the past.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm trying, so this is, again, this is something I put in there as a sort of throwing a fig leaf to the practice, or saying, well, actually, guys, if you want to study historical practice, perhaps you should utilize these kinds of sources that we don't tend to use as much. The narrations are perhaps not the best ones. Let's go to some court cases, because they can tell you about how things were adjudicated. You can go to manuals of, for instance, manuals of warfare. They will not tell you exactly how people fought wars, but they'll at least tell you something about the thinking about war fighting as a practice. Right? So I acknowledge fully, well, that you have to move through a set of constructs here, but I'm throwing, well, trying to throw a branch rather than a stone at the people, at the people doing historical studies of practice, saying, okay, there are some ways of getting at practice, even if you can't study it directly. But of course you have to acknowledge the construction. I fully agree.
Yeah, I think perhaps just to set that in the IR context before we come back to it. I mean, I think that many of us would take issue with the practice term for many, many things, but I think the idea of throwing a branch rather than a stone is an extremely nice one. And it can occasionally seem that some of the practice term practitioners, let's call them that, are rather keen to dispense with discourse, to dispense with all other methods of understanding. Whereas we know there are examples from sociology, from history, of doing this. I mean, we think to Norbert Elias, court conduct, court etiquette. We think to then how that can be combined with Chandra Mukherjee's work on materiality in history. And actually, there's a richer picture that is already out there for a practice term people to look at than we often get in IR. So I think that's a really valuable intervention to make there.
Just to add to that, I mean, historians have been working on materiality for a while now, you know, in
forever.
And particularly recently, there's been some interesting breakthroughs for sort of early modern history, looking at love and then how that is reflected in visual culture and all of this stuff. But anyway, so I had another sort of comment. Oh, yes, okay. So talking when discussing the sources, okay. So you mentioned that historians really like the drier sources, the diplomatic correspondence and you know, going into the Foreign Office archives and being there for, I think you said one day, but it's more like 10 days and just, you know, nonstop clicking of the camera. But anyway, so what I would say to that is that this is something where history has yet to kind of break ground, maybe. So diplomatic history, I find it to be generally kind of maybe in a we talked about this, a crisis mode. It needs a bit of resuscitation in some capacity because it's not as dynamic or as engaged or even, you know, heading in a direction of multi or inter or transdisciplinarity. So one of the things that I tried to do in my own research and wasn't able to extend yet into anything productive, but it was part of my thesis, but anyway. So looking at these drier sources of diplomacy and analyzing them and looking at them for the margins, for what is actually not just the concept of the notion of marginalia, but what is written in the margins of these sources.
Yeah.
And reading them and seeing, okay, well, you know, and there was always a story to be told in the margins that conflicted with what sort of official policy ended up being. I'm talking specifically about the British Foreign Office in the 1930s, for example. So then reading that, you know, I was able to tease out strands of sort of cultural and social commentary. So I would say that these sources are not dry. They just, they need a critical interpretation, as we talked about. And this is what's I think missing maybe in the field of diplomatic history, and something that this potential crossover could facilitate. You know, what you think about that?
Oh yeah, I fully agree. I spent almost a year in archives co-writing the history of the Norwegian Foreign Service.
Wow. Okay.
So yes, but the British Foreign Office example is interesting, fascinating, isn't it? Perhaps it's after the Second World War, we have, someone told me this, that you have these kinds of marginalia. We actually have a red-blooded communist sitting there. He's making sort of communist points in the margins, right? But this is okay within the framework of the SCO. But yes, I think, yes, they are perceived to be drier, but again, this is Arlette Farge has shown with the French archives, there are so much you can tell.
Yeah.
Social history, for instance. Mm-hmm. And I'll give one example which I found fascinating as a Norwegian sort of archival, but this is in the second half of the 1930s. So we need to hire a new boy, sort of a messenger boy, because the ministry is growing. We need to hire a new messenger boy. It's not really a big cost. It's not really a big. But maybe perhaps he should also be sort of charged with guarding the entrance to the second floor. Right? And this single thing will have these annotations, and I counted it went through 24 or 27 different steps of the bureaucracy. It goes down the janitor and up to the Minister of Foreign Affairs twice. About hiring a new guy, the office boy, to run around. And you can, there are so many things you can say based on that, sort of,
yeah.
On how the Norwegian Ministry of Foreign Affairs worked in the run up to the Second World War. But there are some things that tells you something, tells you so many potential other stories.
Absolutely.
Again, this is why I urge people to go into archives, because you realize that there are so many tangents to follow, or sort of why I become a sort of schoolboy engaged, because there's so many things to do, so many paths you can pursue. Then you also realize that I agree with the diplomatic history is dry, and one of the problems with IR and history is that when IR deals with history, it very often deals with diplomatic history, which is in a sense the least open-minded,
absolutely.
The least advanced, the least creative branch of history. I mean, this is where there's a reason why diplomatic historians and IR realists have been able to converse so well. I mean, because and I'll leave it at that.
Yeah.
But yes, I mean, diplomatic history, I think, is well, there is stuff being done.
Yeah.
Obviously, I mean, there's fascinating stuff being done on gender and kinship and stuff like that.
Yes.
For instance, for the early modern period, just stuff is happening, but at a very slow pace.
Yeah.
And it's interesting, when we've spoken about history and IR, and we talked particularly about diplomatic history, it's notable that a lot of the people who specialise in diplomatic history in the Czech Republic are unaware of James Dodarian, unaware
of
Ivan Neumann, unaware of Ole Jakob Zending, unaware of yourself, others who do exactly this kind of work. And there is an issue of IR is not perceived as worth engaging with, and so it's not actually taken up to a certain extent in history much. And I think this issue of how we represent each other, I'm sure Bill will perhaps challenge some part of that, but how we represent each other comes to be an interesting point, which we'll come to in the further discussion. I'll just go back to Teresa for you have another point to make to Howard, or then
I just have one more quick sort of question, and this is more again something that as I've encountered as a historian, I don't know if you have, Bill, we can talk about this as well. This idea that coming up against you mentioned Lawson a few times, and I just wonder, do you think there's any credence to the fact that, or to the notion that we can take kind of the concreteness, the specificity, and the context out of history? What does that leave history with? I find that as a historian, fundamentally, actually, I cannot do that, which then sometimes creates a tension, but not necessarily. You talk about productive tension, and this isn't maybe the most productive of tensions. More like irreconcilable difference.
Yeah.
So what are your thoughts on that?
Here I'm caught between my own vision and hopes for a broad tent way of doing it, and trying to open up thinking space rather than closing down, and my own intellectual proclivity, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because George and John Hobson wrote an article some year about different ways of doing history in international relations, and they don't say, well, you can do what they refer to as non-historicist history. Say, well, which basically is literally the classical neorealist way of doing it, say, oh, well, yeah, there's history, but it doesn't matter, right?
Yeah.
History tells us that history doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So in a sense,
it's truth type stuff, kind of.
In a sociology of knowledge way, or sort of, I want to open up thinking space, I want to be able, I would like to engage those people, and I would like them to feel that historical international relations is for them as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, intellectually speaking, I have a hard time with it.
Okay.
Because I think sort of, to me, it's like there is, if you take out contingency, that there's a you've exited history. So it's just to my like, but again, and I'm not saying that George would do that. I mean, my beef with George is more with on how we approach history and what kinds of things we I think, and I really like George a lot, and I think he does really interesting work. Should be said, but we differ on for instance, how to deal with sources and the extent to how deep you should dig. No, but to me, I mean, you can't. To me, and that's one of the attractions of history. I mean, one of the reasons why I always this is contingency. It isn't. It opens up around the ironic aspects of life. I mean, there's like you it becomes very hard to continue doing unreflective international relations as soon as you start engaging with history seriously.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, but in sort of turning a bit around and go back to what you said about diplomatic history. I mean. One of the funnier things that happen is when you do this kind of trying to open up these thinking spaces that you engage with historians, right? We had in Warsaw conference a few years ago, an historian came to one of our panels and he started out by really giving sort of a scathing review of how IR people have been dealing with his sort of period and slice of history. And we're like, okay, well, that's okay. You found us to be very sort of unsophisticated, and then he let out his sort of theoretically informed, because he wanted to do theoretically informed history. So he led out his theoretically informed version of, and I think 90% of the crowd was like, okay, you dare come in and bash our way of doing history, and you present that silly way of approaching theory? Come on! There is a sense in which, I mean, to me, I mean, one of the problems I have with a number of people doing diplomatic history is sort of a completely unreflective and unacknowledged silly realism, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like yes, but this is the way it is. States act as unitary self, sort of the typical rat choice realist notion of a state. It's like, wow, this is. I don't know anyone in IR who still would cling to that way of putting it like that. So that to me, sort of a yes, of course, they are better at doing history in general than people doing IR, but they have. Again, which goes back to why I chose doing IR rather than doing history, because I like to be trying to be open about my own theoretical proclivities.
Mm-hmm.
But I find so many of the diplomatic historians are just saying, well, and they are the ones who come closest to this Frankian notion of, yeah, we're just telling us like it is. I mean, Henry Kissinger is just laying out like it is, right?
Milan Poloshenska. Telling it how it is.
But Poloshenska is an interesting example of using diplomatic history, a very, very conservative discipline, to actually, in a sense, read against the grain to construct the story of the deportations of white Russians and opponents of the Soviet regime facilitated by Benesch's government in 1944, 1945, 1946.
This is a book.
I know the name Benesch. It makes sense to me. Yeah.
Right, I think what I'm sure many of you have an awful lot of questions to ask. A couple of very brief or comments to make as well, which we also welcome. A couple of very brief observations from my side. This blindness, mutual blindness. There was one of the reasons for putting this together was not only Harvard's kind offer to come and visit us, but because we've been seeking to actually do an event of this kind for some time, provoked by a seminar that was held at King's College last year that posited the title. IR without history is empty, history without IR is blind. And this notion of blindness really came through very strongly, not only in your talk and in the way that you said about the ways we differently approach things, but also in the editing of what explicitly seeks to be an interdisciplinary journal, but an interdisciplinary journal of politics and IR. And so this engaged amateurism concept is very familiar to us. We blunder all over the shop, but at the same time we are doing it through that love of inquiry. And it's through actually exposing what are our different blindnesses, as well as our different ways of seeing, that we've actually found some of the most productive engagements with these other disciplines and with different perspectives within the different parts of our own discipline, which, as I think you rightly mentioned, is becoming increasingly plurally sectarian and incapable of speaking across a broad field. I think it was very nice indeed that you said, you know, this is driven by a desire to find answers to my questions, to go into different places, but then exactly with the Foucauldian notion of making facile gestures more difficult, also to find new questions to your answers. And I think this is then exactly this drive that we can find through the engagement with different disciplines in that regard. I also think the theorising of the international, as well as the introduction of the international, is something that IR can very productively bring to history. And I'd be really interested in the historians' take on this around the room, as well as the IR scholars' take on it. But indeed, in this question of how we represent the other disciplines. I mean, Bill Edelston, who's the historian here based in Prague, have spent many long evenings discussing history and IR, amongst other things. And the level of mutual misunderstanding, I think, is not limited to our conversations, but can be found in the work of notable historians. If we look at Christopher Clark's now very famous book, The Sleepwalkers, it makes quite a stunning claim in the introduction, which says, you know, the First World War is the event that is discussed among international relations scholars, the outbreak of the First War, which came as news to me as an IR scholar, I have to say, but was nonetheless stated as being just that. And Clark, interestingly, reading the Overtures to the Iron Kingdom, his book about Prussia, is one of clearly the more amenable historians to a constructivist approach, and takes what I think could be a very conversible approach with many contemporary IR scholars. And so yet, even though the scholar like that should make such a claim about IR as such, tells you a little bit about how IR is viewed and what IR is actually viewed as in history. So perhaps those are some things that we could turn to in our conversation. But with that said, I will open the floor. If you could raise your hand to show you'd be interested in asking a question or making a comment. And before you do, please introduce yourself. So, the gentleman over there.
Thank you very much, Mr. Talis. My name is Jedi from the Philippines. I'm a practicing diplomat. I've did some studies in diplomacy in Australia. There's a school called Australian National University, and I did work on diplomacy, not just IR. Mm. So as a diplomat, I'd like to, I'm curious, I'm sort of an amateur in terms of this curiosity. There's a lot of diplomats writing books about their own stories. So these are oral histories. Makes some sense, but in a way it's also one way for them to express themselves. But if a diplomat, young or somebody who's retiring, would like to write about diplomacy, the way they view it and they experience it as a practitioner, how does an IR specialist, a political scientist, and a historian be able to help them?
Mm-hmm.
For instance, many diplomats, after they leave, many of them are no longer IR graduates. They come from all different fields. They may come from law, economics, they may even be the field of medicine. So the IR theory is no longer something that influences diplomats, nor politicians. Maybe the IR analyst would look at this based on their behavior, that they're acting in this way, because state is realist, they're liberal, or this new thing about constructivism. 20 years ago, I didn't hear about this constructivism. It's only recently that I heard it from Roos at the ANU. But many diplomats know about history, because we know what is and why it happened, what happened, why it happened, and how it happened. So perhaps they could write something. So how does a diplomat practitioner would like to be to write about history and link with a historian and a political scientist, an IR specialist.
Thank you very much indeed. We'll collect just a couple more questions and also keep Harvard some thinking time as to how to respond. That was a very in-depth and interesting question, that one. Who else would like to raise a point in this first round? Bill, you've been chomping at the bit.
No, but I've already said that. I mainly wanted to say that I think that was a mischaracterization of contemporary history. That's really
yeah? Okay.
all it wanted
I'm
to.
I'm sure something else will
I'm sure. And then I'll raise my hand.
Excellent. Who else for this? Vitek.
Hi, I'm Vit Benesh from this institute. I will play a role of devil's advocate. One critical comment at the beginning, you seem to confuse history and history with big H as a discipline. When you said that the international relations are historical because they do study historical facts. But the thing, yeah, we do study historical facts. Actually, any empirical discipline is historical with small age, you know, be it economics, be it sociology, be it, I don't know, psychology, whatever. Any empirical discipline, including actually the natural sciences, they also study historical facts. So in this sense, any discipline, empirical discipline, is historical with small age. But it does not automatically make them historical with big age. So that's my critical comment. The first one, the second one, you suggested that history, probably history with small age or with big age, can serve as a lingua franca for the fragmented field of international relations. I do agree with the assessment that we are very much fragmented. Mm. That's obvious, but I'm not sure if history can play that role, because, as you said, history is too complex. Actually, any historian makes the choice of which sources he will study, for example. So I'm not sure if history can play that role.
Okay. Maybe later.
Yeah, and so these are two critical comments and one question, friendly one, an ethical one.
Having thrown the stones, you'll now throw the branch. Huh?
Somewhere in your papers, you have mentioned the idea of treating secondary sources as primary ones. I very much subscribe to the idea that within a certain epistemological position, it's absolutely useful to treat secondary sources as primary one, as recordings of observers, which are at the same time creating reality or constructing the reality. Mm-hmm. So maybe you can expand on that idea.
Great. Okay. Do you want to have a?
Yeah, I think I'll try to start with the first question. How to write? How can diplomats write diplomatic history or diplomatic theory and make sense of it to the professionals? If that's one way of putting the question, I think. Well,
perhaps you can relate about the book that you wrote about service.
Yes, for that
you spoke about this foreign service, which are the diplomats, not necessarily the foreign policy.
Yes, and that was one of the things that was interesting about that book, writing that book, was that the historians were not furious with us, but the historians were sort of, why don't you write more about foreign policy? So we were not writing about foreign policy, we were not rewriting the history of foreign policy, we're writing about the actual institution. Whereas the diplomatic historians in Norway had tended to focus on the history of Norwegian foreign relations. And of course, for that book, we read a number of autobiographies. And again, I get this might just be Norwegian diplomats, but they were extremely boring. It's pompous asses writing about all the important people that met and. Boring! Yes, I want to write my life because I'm so important and I'm now retired. I mean, there are some problems with autobiography as a genre as such. And I mean, people who have spent most of their time perhaps outside of their country of birth might not sort of be completely in touch with what's happened at home, to put it with sort of a nice way. You took up an interesting point, of course, and I'll have two more points I want to make. First of all, I would really hope that more people who come from the inside of diplomacy write about diplomacy, for the very simple reason that this is a fairly hard arena to get access to. I mean, if you're a social scientist trying to write about practices of diplomacy, I mean, usually hard to get on the inside of ministries of foreign affairs and embassies. Maybe you can get in on lower levels, but if you're going in sort of saying, yes, I would like to write about diplomacy, I'd like to study you guys while you're doing diplomacy, that's hard. So I would love for more people who are actually active diplomats to, when they retire or if even mid-career, jump ship and do something else. There are a number of people who have been doing that. Jeff Weissman is one, Kishan Rana is another, and there are examples of that. Now, he said, of course, that a number of people who are in diplomacy don't have IR training, and they might know history, yes. And interestingly enough, I think there's, again, there's a variation between countries, but my general impression is that diplomatic training as such has been much reduced over the years. It used to be much more intensive. But with the need to actually get people to sort of move paper from inboxes to outboxes. I know the Scandinavian case is best, but there's sort of the where diplomatic training 100 years ago, 50 years ago, was fairly in depth. They learned sort of a lot of stuff. Now it's largely sort of a tour of Norwegian export industries, right? They're not necessarily exposed to different ways of thinking. On the other hand, they tend to come in with higher degrees than they had with 50 years or 100 years ago. They have more formal training before they enter. But I think it's an important caveat to people studying international relations. And again, one of the reasons why I think we should be less sort of ambitious with our theories when studying this, because of course, as anyone who's been doing public policy knows, a theory goes out the window as soon as you start. I mean, you have to get through that pile of papers, and you have to do it before you pick up your kids in kindergarten and go home and make dinner. I mean, the best article I've read about this is almost 60 years old, and it's by Charles Lindblom. It's called The Science of Muddling Through. Mm-hmm. There's a reason why when you're studying big bureaucracies, you might have more use in theories you learn in public administration and organization theories than you might have from your IR theories. There's a reason why you find some really, really interesting stuff coming out in people having studied formal organizations and formal bureaucracies. Mm-hmm. When you're trying to make foreign policy, I mean, even Henry Kissinger wasn't sitting back thinking about sort of, yes, the most realistic thing to do is, I mean, that's not the way it works. I mean, you have a problem. And how do you usually solve a problem? Not telling you, this is not a specific Norwegian case. How you give a foreign office official a problem, how do they approach that problem? Well, they look at what we did the last time, right? That's the first reaction. What was the last time we had some trouble with Germany? What did we do? Oh, we got invaded, yeah. Let's not repeat that. But again, you look at the dossier. That's the first reaction of any foreign office. I wouldn't say in any country, but in most countries. What did we do the last time we had this sort of thing came up? So you don't, this is sort of, you make a cognitive shortcut. You don't need to sort of, you don't sit down and think, well, how can I optimize my rational choice strategy? Oh, no! I need to solve this problem. What did we do the last time? Did it work? Yes, we'll do it again. Did it work? No, let's find out something else. I mean, if you spend any time in any sort of working bureaucracy, you start realizing that all the fancy theories are not wrong, but that they lack sort of that component. There is sort of the notion that states act like rationally unitary actors. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Useful for analysis, but I mean, you lose out on a number of things, I can tell you that. So, again, yes, and I think both IR scholars and historians should acknowledge that, yes, diplomats don't think in theoretical terms. Most of the time they don't. So, second set of questions. On the capital history versus, I can show you my manuscript, I actually have, I've made that distinction. So even though I probably didn't come out since you want to arrest me, I 100% agree. I mean, and I also tried to say that in a very sort of superficial sense, all sciences are historical, lower age, because they deal with historical stuff, right? There is no stuff that's not historical. Well, there's the future things, but of course, but that doesn't imply that they deal with history, capital H. I fully agree, and I think I haven't phrased myself clearly enough, but I fully agree that this is a distinction we need to make. Second, on history, a small letter as a lingua franca, you're skeptical of the possibility as... It's more of a hope than an assertion, and what I also, in a sense, and you're right in saying that history is too complex. What I do find, though, is that what you might find, and why also thinking that this is a lingua franca, it's an opening up of spaces, but it's a fleeting opening up. Because, let's say, for instance, you give, and I've seen this happen, right? A new piece of historical work comes out, and people from different varieties of international relations pick it up, and they all like it. And then they start discussing it. Like, oh, this is really, really cool. I mean, this is... And then after a while, you take some stuff from that, and you go back to your theoretical little bulwark, or you realize that, wow, this guy was a Marxist. I don't like Marxists, so I'll go do something else. But so it's a fleeting opening up. And also why I gloss over in this notion of this is a lingua franca is, of course, that, well, yes, as I said earlier, all these historians write histories from their perspective. So it's not like you can, I mean, a neutral lingua franca is impossible. That's a no-go. I mean, intellectual. So I'd say this is a rhetorical ploy I'm using here. I'm sharing it now with you on video, so now everyone knows that. But I think it's a useful way of opening up and saying, before, what we can do is have this historical thing happening. And you've tried this several times with sort of workshops, setting up with people coming from different branches of IR, throwing out something. For instance, okay, how can we think about the medieval to modern transition? I've got a workshop on that at the ISA this year. That's a good question. Different ways of thinking about it. Some people really stick to it, say, oh, this is an important notion. We need the notion of a break. Others say, well, building on other historians, say, well, this actually doesn't really work out that way. But at least you have a conversation. So for a fleeting moment, you're in the sandbox laboratory, lingua franca, where you open things up. Mm-hmm. And it's not a stable state. I mean, there is no such thing as a stable, neutral language. I mean, this is what the logical positivist is trying to find. We're not finding it. But it's a situation where you can actually sort of encourage people to recognize the other. I mean, for better words, it's an ethical stance where you say, well, whereas perhaps, when dealing with current affairs, it's better for your political purposes, or your political purposes might be political and within the discipline, it's better not to acknowledge the other, not to acknowledge their position, just to refuse it. At least I have the hope and some experience with sort of playing with history, opening up these kinds of thinking spaces and opening up sort of at least the acknowledgement of, okay, that's a valid way of thinking about it. It's not my way. Mm-hmm. And so you have no, eventually you'll have a closing down, or if not a closing down, there's sort of retrenchment. Mm-hmm. But it's the sort of the notion that for a while we can have an opening up, hopefully. On the treating secondary sources as primary ones, yes, I think that's one of the things that, to me at least, the discourse analysis has brought to IR, sort of, or to the ways of doing textual analysis in social sciences, that, yeah, well, we shouldn't really only focus on what the text says, we should talk about its condition of the whole notion of discourse, sort of what makes it possible to say this? How is it possible for me to say that Norway is a peace nation? I wouldn't say it, but people do say it. So I think, yes, I'll take all of them as branches. Part of our disagreement is that I haven't been clear enough, and part of it is that we don't really disagree, but that you saw through my rhetorical ploys.
I think just to pick up on a couple of those points quickly, this idea that history can at least temporarily provide that ground upon which to talk, it's extremely important, not only in scholars who deal with contemporary political issues, but scholars whose theoretical positions, if discussed outside of history, become an issue within the discipline. I mean, these big stage discussions that we've perhaps seen at the ISA where trying to pitch John Mearsheimer against Ole Weber or something like this, there's too much invested on each part in each person's career to make that a contemporary valid discussion to have in many ways without it getting seriously vicious. And without the plural sectarianism coming to bite everybody. Exactly, this can really be a way where there's somehow seemingly less at stake in the immediate here and now, and so it does indeed provide that space, which I think is really very useful and of mutual interest, and that curiosity meets, and the curiosity of the scholar from any of these points of view can really be expressed through that forum.
Just to add on that for a second, I think also one of the things that can happen is that, again, because there is less vested interest, there is less sort of career building on what history or engaging with history in this way actually allows to happen is that both the differences and the similarities between theories become clearer. Because we can actually sort of, okay, now that we're not fighting over what counts as relevant data, now that we're not sort of engaged in the usual sort of territorial discussions, we can actually say, okay, we're looking at not a current affairs, we're looking at some case from going back tens, hundreds of years. we actually have fairly similar, our theories come to fairly similar conclusions about this case. How come? What does that imply for our different ways of theorizing? You can bring out both, again, both differences and similarities, which seem very, very, very important in the high-pitched debates of 2016.
Exactly.
You see this, right? When people try and say, okay, what about realist constructivism? There is a reason why a number of people who try to sort of see if you can play with combining different ways of theorizing, that they sometimes take a detour back, right? They go back to history and say, okay, maybe, well, it turns out. And probably not a coincidence that, for instance, Dan Nexon, who's been sort of at least sort of engaged in some of these discussions about realist constructivism, wrote his PhD on sort of early modern Europe.
Mm. And studied with Charles Tilly, amongst others.
And studied with Jack Tilly, yeah. So that's on. Yes.
Yeah, I think that's, I think, a really extremely valuable way of putting it. And I can't help but think it would draw me back to another one of your pieces, though, the Big Bangs. If we've all actually been through the same Big Bangs in our learning, then it brings us back to what is common amongst our interests and the way we've been taught IR, which obviously you problematise in, a very compelling fashion. But indeed, we do have those issues in common that we can actually then talk around in a less conflictual way. Just in terms of theory and practice of IR, this is an issue that is really relevant to this institute as well as to NUPE and to others. We're also an applied research institution as well as an academic research institution, and we were just lucky enough on Wednesday to have a talk here from our former director, Petr Drulák, who went on to become the first deputy foreign minister quite recently. And having been someone who I would loosely and broadly characterise as having gone in with a particular theoretical approach, he certainly came out with a very pragmatic approach, having perhaps been mugged by reality, amongst other things. But I would put it that actually, while we may not put the theory first when doing those kind of things, even if you think you're finished with theory isn't finished with you at that point, and the theory emerges through those cracks, and indeed through whichever pragmatic way we actually do approach those issues, some theoretical framework actually is still relevant to that. So I think in addressing that question, which I think was a really good one, about how these histories can be more influenced, informed, and can inform the theory that we use and the way that we study practice, the conversation and encounter and engagement between the practitioners and the theoreticians. This is something that many of us, I think, in this room who do IPS type work, be it historical, spatial, sociological, whatever we would like to describe it as, are extremely keen on, is encouraging these encounters, because through those encounters we become less strange to each other. And indeed can actually learn, again, in exactly the way that you're saying, I think, that history and IR can learn from being more historical in that sense. Right, let's open up to some more questions.
Just one comment about that, what you said. Yeah. In diplomacy, that the IR theories can be a toolbox if the diplomats, contemporary ones, even the political diplomats who come in, not as a career diplomat, can learn about, okay, by this time this is what we're using, it's realist, it's liberal, because we're now promoting regionalism, and then constructivism for public diplomacy. So those things, then you kind of have a method that, I don't know if you think that's because diplomats are very practical in its orientation, so this may be one thing.
Yeah, and I find that, I mean, the most common reaction you get from diplomats when you start talking about IR theories, that it's sort of, yeah, whatever. Mm-hmm. You and your theories. So I think the whole, and this again goes to some, of course, to some extent to translation, right? I mean, there's, you would hope to come to a place where diplomats would think that IR scholars, more so than historians, because historians, for better words, are often working at applied research institutes, that we would have more to say to one another. Because I find that, well, many diplomats tend to look at IR scholars and say, yeah, you are sort of living in your ivory tower, a bit confused, theory-driven, whereas many IR scholars tend to look at practicing diplomats as terribly naive and empiricist.
unthinking reproducers of repressive discourse.
Those were your words.
As it has been styled elsewhere.
Those were your words. Engaged in mediating estrangement. It was funny, but I think in some ways some of the most theoretically influenced work on diplomacy, like Derrida's work on diplomacy, or even its... Well, I lost track when it got to Hegel. I always lose track when it comes to Hegel. But still, I think some of the things he says about diplomacy, I think he has this notion defining diplomacy as the mediation of estrangements. And I've led this theorizing out to a number of people who do diplomacy, and they find, well, this is compelling. Mm. This makes sense, sort of seeing diplomacy as a sort of third culture, engaging in and sort of greasing the wheels. Also, part of English school theorizing about diplomacy is something that there's a reason why many of the people who retire as diplomats when they take up or go to the English school, right? Because it makes some sort of, in the English school, in the best part, is of course trying to base itself on practice. There's a hidden practice element to a number of English school thinking. So there are openings where I are, and practicing diplomats can actually meet and have good conversations, but I would hope that it could be better.
Yeah, and I think part of that is exactly how we translate it. Exactly, the mediation of estrangement is a wonderful term for very clearly getting across what is intuitive to most of those who work in diplomatic practice. And those of us who have worked with diplomatic status in the past would, I think, very much recognise that. It depends also which context you're talking about. In some diplomatic context or government bureaucracy context, particularly I'm thinking of in Brussels and around the EU apparatus, you will find people who are very well educated in IR theory, who are very keen to show you they are very well educated in IR theory, and who will practically steal your words out of your mouth when you're talking about these things, which makes for a different kind of conversation. Increasingly, it happens in other circles too, and I think it's a bit of a myth that, you know, we do this irrelevant theory and diplomats do this real pragmatic, practical stuff. There is far more grey zone than we would, I think, give credit to a lot of the time, although there are still issues of translation. Right, with that said, I know we have at least two more questions. Let's, if we have any more for now, speak now or forever hold your peace, because this should be probably our last round. Okay, on those two, please.
So my name is George Power, I teach history here in Prague, and I'd like to ask two pretty brief questions. First of all, for the IR specialist doing historical research, are there any restrictions that you would advocate in terms of time period or historical problem, or is it just open? And secondly, just following from the point about the gentleman in Warsaw at this conference, and Christopher Clark, and what he said about World War I, do we need, engaged amateurism in the other direction?
Well, yes, start with the last question. Yes, I would love to have more engaged amateurism the other way. I love talking to historians. I should tell you, it usually scares me. I mean, I'm presenting, not this kind of stuff necessarily, presenting empirical stuff to historians, it scares the living shit out of me. But it's also the most rewarding experience that I have, because particularly if they're gentle, when they'll usually tear it apart, but they'll often tear it apart in ways that sort of make me aware of my own shortcomings and make me aware of other things that I should study. But that as a side note, yes, I would love historians, and some historians are engaging IR and social theory as amateurs, and I find that enormously rewarding. And they write sort of stuff that I find, wow. Some of them I find to be sort of naive when it comes to theory, but still sort of, they're trying sort of to build a bridge from their side up. I'm not saying we're doing bridge building exercises necessarily going to lead us anywhere, when there's the famous story of the bridge to nowhere in Sarah Palin's vice presidential campaign. But yes, I would love that. And you see it from a number of historians, particularly younger here. Of course, I include myself in the younger still, so I don't know. But I mean, the people who are, over the last 20, 30, 40 years, have been opening up towards sort of not only social theorizing, not only economic history kind of theorizing, but in general, more to the social sciences, looking at sort of taking in and Foucauldian notions, taking in and Bourdieu, or building up different other theories of IR, if you like. And, you know, saying, sometimes explicitly saying, well, this is what a realist take on this would look like. This is what a constructivist take would look like. Wow, this is cool. You're trying to sort of you're trying to talk to me as well.
Yeah.
But I love it when it happens. And I although I sometimes think it's the fairly naive way of dealing with theory, I try to be generous and open. On the second question, on are there any restrictions on what IR scholars should be studying? Yes and no. I think I'll start with no in the sense that, well, as social scientists, I think nothing human should be strange to us. I mean, you want to study the full set of cases, right? You want to study all places at all times. If you're trying to do social theorizing, why restrict your number of cases? You're trying to be social scientists. We try to look at, for better or worse, some general things. On the other hand, then, there's the immediate caveat. I think that, historically speaking, international relations has been extremely bad at acknowledging difference, right? I think, and this is my personal take, is that the further you go back, particularly if you go back beyond, say, I think, and there's a reason why, the aforementioned George Lawson and Barry Bazana look out about the great transformation of the 19th century, published a couple of years ago, the great critical acclaim. We had a round table on that at the ISA, which I chair, at which point Chris Rue-Smith, another IR luminary, stands up and says, so you mean we should actually stop, sort of, what you're actually saying is that we should stop dealing as IR scholars with things before 1815, right? And which I countered, said, no, Chris, I mean, you should stop doing it, you shouldn't stop doing it, but you should come with us over the historical IR thing rather than trying to make this. And there has been an enormous arrogance in international relations about sort of what time period. I mean, oh yes, Amarna diplomacy. We can study Amarna diplomacy as in just the same way as we study diplomacy, right? And is this a reason why
I'm laughing because I actually learned Akkadian when I was an undergraduate on Amarna diplomacy. So no. Yeah, it's not something you want to step into without a...
No, there is published an article, I think it's in the Review of International Studies a number of years ago, about the foreign policy of Middle Kingdom Egypt. And like, there are so many problems with doing that. So where do you start? So I think there is this institutional arrogance of international relations that our theories apply to all times. Mm-hmm. And I think it largely comes from realism. I mean, this is the sins that realism has bequeathed to the discipline as such. The sort of belief that our theories are valid wherever, whenever. So that's the no answer. I think the yes answer is that yes, I think, in principle, if you're interested in history and doing IR, you could go and study things. The no is not really a no, it's more sort of, but be aware of what you're doing. Don't be stupid, don't be silly.
Yeah.
If you want to study New Kingdom Egypt or Middle Kingdom Egypt, please do it. But try not to use words like diplomacy or foreign policy that were born during the French Revolution. You might think that it makes sense to refer to a chariot as a car, but you wouldn't do it because it isn't a car. Right?
But at the same time, it's an interesting point because with some engagements with architecture and architectural history that I've undertaken, looking at the way some architectural history is taught, particularly at undergrad level in big American universities, let's use a broad term, prestigious ones, you think, my goodness, I wish they had studied a lick of international relations, just some idea or of social science or of policy or anything to do with this. It would bring so much more to that analysis, much like one often thinks when reading wonderful ethnographies. You think, my God, if any understanding of the state here or what the state can and can't do would be a fantastic addition to this. So I think you're 100% right, but there's another way to it as well. I know we have a point from Henry.
Glad to see Rick, and I used to work for the MOD UK as a senior analyst looking at first Soviet Union and then Russia. In my professional life, I have never heard anybody using words like constructivism, Foucault, and every time the words international relations theory was mentioned, they were reaching for their guns. This is to some extent, but that's Hermann Göring for you. That's to some extent understandable because after all, you academics after every debate you have a conclusion. The decision makers have a decision, and most of it is time sensitive, and most of it is you have to do something about that. Mm-hmm. Now, as a result, people in the big countries, as opposed to small countries, which the Czech Republic is one of them, are the victims of a tyranny of the immediate. The important thing here is that it is not going to change. And the problem I have, as a stakeholder of two kids, and one of them graduated from Prague University and took my wife and me several months to undo the damage which the university did to her. You do funny things to our kids, I would say. And here is the question, it's very personal. If somebody turned the clock of your life and said, you can study anything but not international relations theory, what would you study?
I ended up studying international relations theory almost by accident. I probably would have studied history.
Thank you.
But then again, I think I still would have had the problem. I still would have encountered the problems that I had with many historians. And again, I won't say all historians. I tried not to say all historians during my presentation as well. The notion that you can have a theory-free presentation on something to me is ludicrous. Mm-hmm. I mean, of course you're coming with some baggage. Even the people at the MOV who say they reach for the guns when they hear the word theory. So yeah, they have a theory of action. Of course they have a theory of action. They're not just reacting. Well, some MFAs are just reacting, I'll give them that. But no, mm-hmm. Jokes aside. Of course there is an unspoken theory, but you have this. The moment you start saying like small and great states, well, very soon you end up saying, well, that's just the way it is, which is the way I very often hear from ministries of defense, perhaps even more from ministries of defense than from ministries of foreign affairs. Yes, we're just dealing with the world as it is. Mm. At which point we go, yeah, right, it's the world as it is. So my counter would be to you, so if you weren't allowed to sort of sit and say that in a ministry saying, well, we're just reacting to the world as it is, how would you react to someone saying, well, for what reason? It's not that simple. But I fully agree with you that the tyranny of the immediate. And there's a reason why I'm saying that. I think we should scale down our ambitions, and that our theorists are, and social science people in general tend to be arrogant also when it comes to sort of studying functioning bureaucracies. But I mean, there's a reason why it's Charles Lindon and the science of muddling through is what best explains how bureaucracies deal with it. I mean, you have a problem, you have to solve it. I mean, you have to land a decision. I fully agree with this. But there is the difference. I mean, you shouldn't conflate the level of action and the level of analysis. There's a reason why we have analysis. There's a reason why we take a step back. What we shouldn't forget is that something is lost during that step back. Mm. This is, I mean, again, because what I think good constructivism can add to the mix is that, yes, there is a life world. We can never really be on the inside of that life world. We take an analytical step back. We have to not forget that this is. We shouldn't conflate our. What is the saying? We shouldn't conflate our our model of the world with the world of our models, right? there is. I mean, in a sense, yes, and I fully agree with you to some extent. I have problems with IR theory as well. In a sense, people are sort of trading French theorists or American theorists or sort of sitting there. I mean, and this goes not only for people doing Foucault or Bourdieu. I mean, it goes for, have you read anything about rational choice and the big number of French things that you find in American journals? I mean, that's completely unreadable. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can't read it without a degree in mathematics. Tell me how that's useful for policymakers, how that relates to policymakers. I mean, it's not like someone had found the panacea here. So. Yes, I fully agree with that. I hopefully your daughter will come out as not as damaged goods, but she'll reflect on her experience.
She's not normal, she's alright.
Yes, and I'll end on that note that yes, and I think one of the where I started, and one of the things that I think history should induce in Irish followers is an awareness of this is what Arthur Gilbert's words, the ironic nature of human affairs.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think, yeah, it's really interesting to ask exactly how is it that we come to see that as being the world as it is? How did we actually come to actually reach that point? And are there other ways of doing that? And this certainly spoke to an impulse that I had when I was working as a practitioner, and I looked for other ways to understand, because I was fed up with the way from inside, the way it was. And actually then the move to academia was to try and productively understand that, as well as the surplus of meaning that was produced by actually working in that field. And there is indeed some back and forth between the two, and something is lost and something is gained in both directions. And there's better ways and worse ways of doing it, which I think is perhaps the crucial thing. It's not what you do, it's how well. And IR theory can be done incredibly badly, but also incredibly well and incredibly usefully in a way that can be illuminating. What I would hope is that our burgeoning international political sociology, or IPS, as we use as a shorthand, community here in Prague, will be inspired by this talk to do more historically and to actually have a better idea about how we go about doing historical international relations. And so, with that hope, I would ask you to join me in thanking Dr. Havard-Lehrer for a fascinating afternoon.